lest I forget thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary. Let's stand. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary. This weekend, the married couples will have their Valentine retreat. If you haven't signed up, there are just a very few openings, and I would encourage you to enjoy a weekend away with your Valentine and just have a great time at this weekend retreat. Bill and Donita Stonebreaker, Bill is our Calvary Chapel pastor in Honolulu, and they'll be the special guest speakers for the retreat this weekend. And so you can go in after the service and sign up. Wives, give your husband a nudge and say, let's go, you know. And Valentine, and just enjoy. You may be seated. And shall we turn in our Bible to Acts chapter 17? Tonight we begin with verse 10. Paul has been called of God to take the gospel to Europe. He wanted to go to Asia, but the Spirit forbade him. And so he tried to go into Bithynia. Again, the Spirit stopped him. But then by divine call, Paul was called of God to go over to Macedonia, that area of Europe, and to begin ministering over there. So he came to Philippi, and God blessed. There was a move of God's Spirit, many conversions, but he ended up in the Philippian jail, and with the request of the magistrates to leave town. So he went from there to Thessalonica, and again, a successful ministry as far as people being converted, a strong church established. But again, there came sort of an insurrection, and he had to leave town under the cover of darkness. And so leaving Thessalonica, he makes the 60-mile journey to Berea. Now, if you're looking at a map of that area, you'll find that Thessalonica is on the coast, as is Berea, 60 miles south and slightly west from Thessalonica. And the brethren immediately, this is from Thessalonica, sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. It is interesting, as Paul is here in Europe, the persecution is instigated by the Jews. And at the beginning of the church, the persecution against the church came from the Jews. Later on, the chief persecutors became the Romans. The Jews were upset mainly because they were teaching through Jesus Christ the resurrection of the dead, and the Sadducees, which was the dominant sect among the Jews at that time, they had the Pharisees and the Sadducees. The Sadducees actually sort of controlled, they were the high priest and the controlling class. They did not believe in resurrection, in spirit or in angels. And so they were upset that disciples were actually declaring that Jesus rose from the dead. And that was contrary to their basic doctrine. And thus they persecuted the early church in Jerusalem. And as Paul is carrying the gospel, taking it, first of all, to the Jews, again, the same kind of persecution is rising against Paul from the Jews wherever they are going. As I said, later on, the persecution will come from the Roman government because they more or less deified the Caesars. And the Christians would refuse to acknowledge Caesar as Lord, and thus they would actually be put to death for the refusal to acknowledge Caesar as Lord. So we read concerning the early church in Jerusalem, being they were arrested by the Jews. It said, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection of the dead. It came against their dogma. So we see that in Thessalonica, the Jews were the ones who led the uprising against Paul and his company. Now, the true church will always be hated by the world. Jesus said, "And you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved." In John 15, 18 and 19, Jesus said, "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. And if you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you." We see the hatred of the world against Jesus Christ manifested in many different ways today. We see it manifested in the way people love to put down Jesus Christ or put down those who believe in Jesus Christ. We see it in the blasphemous depictions of Jesus Christ that are created by some of the modern artists. And of course, the whole thing there is that they are drawing funds from the National Association of Arts. So in reality, part of our taxes are going to support these artists that like to show Jesus in a very unsavory light. But that's just the hatred of the world, and we're not to marvel that the world hates us. Jesus said, the servant isn't greater than his Lord, and if they didn't receive him, they're not going to receive us. Jesus said to his disciples, "In this world, you will have tribulation." Now, there's a lot of debate in the church today as to whether or not the church will go through the great tribulation. And people will bring up, well, you know, the church is going through tribulation. There have probably been as many martyrs for Jesus Christ in the last few years as there has been in any other period in church history. There are hundreds of people that are being martyred in Indonesia, many more being martyred in the Philippines, those that are being martyred in the nations that are really opposed, Africa, the Christians are being slaughtered in the Sudan and in other parts of Africa, and there are thousands of people annually being killed because of their faith in Jesus Christ. And the world is antagonistic. It hates those who believe in Jesus Christ. So yes, the church does experience tribulation. Jesus said that we would. But when you talk about tribulation and you talk about the great tribulation, you're talking about two different things. The tribulation that the church experiences is the anger of Satan against those who believe in Jesus Christ. And Satan actually is the instigator of the persecution of the church and of the believers. When you talk about the Great Tribulation, it is instigated by God. It is God's wrath that is to be poured out upon an unbelieving, ungodly world that has rebelled against God and has rejected God's provision for their salvation. The Great Tribulation is something far different from the tribulation that the church experiences. The Great Tribulation, the source of that is God Himself in the judgment and the wrath of God being poured out. We do read in the judgments of God that are coming that the people will call for the rocks and the mountains to fall on them, to hide them from the face of the Lamb, for the day of His wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand? Satan hates you who believe in Jesus Christ, and he is going to bring tribulation upon you from the world in which we live that is in rebellion against God. They that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, a promise that I hate, but yet it's there. They that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So we find the early church was persecuted. Now, it should be noted that the church has really never suffered as the result of persecution, but the church has always flourished during the time of persecution. The reason being, when you are being persecuted for Christ's sake, he said, "Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad. Great is your reward in heaven." And it really, in persecution, it separates the sheep from the goats. I mean, there are those who, well, Jesus said the seed falls on the different types of soil. And some of the seed fell among thorns. And they grew up together, but, well, actually the stony ground, it grew up quickly, but then when the sun came out, that it withered and died. And so is that person who hears the gospel, receives it with joy, but there's no depth. And when persecution comes, they fall away. And so it has been, but persecution really separates the men from the boys. And if you are truly committed to the Lord, your commitment grows under persecution. And it really creates a stronger bond and a stronger unity because of our suffering together for Christ. Interesting that during the time that communism had, and still does control China, but during the years of communist control, when it was forbidden by their laws to be a Christian, that the underground church, the house church, flourished. And there were millions of Chinese who were believers under the communist regime. The gospel had a greater effect upon China during the communist reign than it ever did during the reign of, say, Chiang Kai-shek, and who was a Christian, and during the time when the Christian missionaries had a free reign over there, the gospel did not flourish nearly as much in that period of history as it has from the time that the communists took over, because it really then takes a real commitment to live for Jesus Christ. And your lives are bound together in a much stronger bond, and you really experience that unity within the body of Christ. So Paul and Silas have been experiencing what Jesus said, you know, the persecution. And they leave Thessalonica under the cover of darkness. They continue the westward journey and south to Berea, which again was a seacoast town, which was 60 miles away from Thessalonica. Now again, according to Paul's custom, he first went to the synagogue. And we read concerning those in Berea that they were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and then they searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. Some people reject the claims of Jesus Christ without ever examining them. Some people have totally rejected our Lord Jesus Christ, and they really know nothing about the gospel. But they've rejected it before even hearing it. Their minds are not open to the gospel at all. They have a closed mind. Now, those in Berea, they had an open mind. Now, they were more noble. That is, they were more open-minded than those in Thessalonica. Not only were they open-minded, but they were willing to search the scriptures to see if the things that Paul was teaching were actually in the scriptures. Is Paul teaching us the word of God? Are the things that Paul is saying concerning the Messiah, are they really found in the scriptures? And as we read the 22nd Psalm tonight, I'm sure that that's one of the scriptures that Paul pointed the people to as it talked about death by crucifixion, as it talked about their piercing his hands and his feet, as it talked about their parting his garments among them, casting lots upon his vesture, as he talked about how they would mock, saying, he saved others, himself he cannot save. But I'm sure that Paul also pointed out to them other scriptures, such as the 89th Psalm that spoke about the stone which the builders rejected becoming the chief cornerstone. He no doubt talked to them about Isaiah 53 and how it tells of the rejection of the Messiah. Despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and how that all of our sins were laid upon him. And as God said, it was for the transgression of my people was he actually slain. He made his death, or he was with the wicked, or with the rich in his death. And so the scriptures that spoke of Jesus Christ. Isaiah 56, I gave my back to the smiters and my cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. I hid not my face from shame and spitting. Zechariah 9:9, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem, behold, your king is coming to you. He is just, he has salvation, he's lowly, he's riding on a donkey. Zechariah 12:10, I will pour out upon the house of David, upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the spirit of grace and supplication. They will look upon me whom they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one that mourns for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one is in bitterness for his firstborn. And so Paul would bring these scriptures to them. They go, and they would look it up to see whether or not what Paul was saying was actually true. Are those things actually in the scriptures? And that is a good, open-minded, fair way. Don't reject something before you give it an honest look. And, you know, it's interesting that a lot of people have been converted in a determination to prove the Bible is not God's word. We've had many cases where a wife would accept the Lord here at Calvary, and her husband would be upset, and he was going to just prove to her how foolish this whole thing was. And he started to read the Gospel of John. He's going to critique the thing and tear it apart and then tear her faith apart. And by the time he gets through, he's converted. And he's joining her in church and sitting by her side. And that's brought a conversion of a lot of people. You see, we prejudge. We come with a prejudice against the scriptures when we start to read. But if you will read with an open mind, I am convinced that you will become convinced of the truth of the Bible and of the truth of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who gave himself that we might live. So because they were diligent, searched the scriptures, we read that many of them believed. And so we read, therefore, many of them believe, verse 12, also of the honorable women, which were Greeks, and of men, not a few. Luke sort of describes things not like an evangelist, but in a diminutive way. Rather than saying, there were just a great bunch of people that were saved. He says, well, there were saved not a few, you know, I mean, rather than sort of boasting of great numbers, he sort of played it down. Not a few. It would probably be better if we would be more in that inclination as far as numbers are concerned. Because numbers should not be our concern. They might be the Lord's concern, but they are not and should not be our concern. For years, I was in the bondage to numbers. It used to be in our churches, they always had a little board up on the side that said, how many in Sunday school this Sunday, how many last Sunday, how many a year ago? And the numbers were always posted. And so you were always aware of numbers. And they can be very defeating. How come there were more last year than there are now? You know, what's happening? Or, you know, we're down from last Sunday. What's going on? And you're into bondage to numbers. And God deliver us from that. And I can remember how upset the church was when I took the board down. I wanted to free them from numbers. It's interesting, when we took the board down, the church grew. And deliver us, Lord, from the bondage of numbers. And so I like the way Luke puts it. Not a few, there were a lot. So again, we see that the same truth, as it is being declared, has mixed results. Isn't that interesting? People can be sitting side by side, hearing the same message. One of them believes and receives the gift of eternal life. The other, sitting next to them, rejects the truth and is destined for eternal separation from God. Same message, both exposed to the same truth. One is saved, one is lost. I think we have it when Jesus was hanging on the cross between two thieves. They were both equally close to death. It was just a matter of hours for both of them. So they were equally close to eternity. But they were also, both of them, equally close to salvation, as Jesus was in the middle between them. One of the thieves was mocking Jesus. Joining the crowd, he said, if you're the Messiah, save yourself and us too. The other said, "Don't you fear God, seeing that we're in the same condemnation? But we are here because we deserve to be here. This man has done nothing amiss." And turning to Jesus, he said, "Lord, when you come into your kingdom, would you remember me?" They both saw the inscription above the cross, "Jesus, the King of the Jews." They both had the same exposure. One was saved, one was lost. The gospel always brings mixed reactions. Many believed. Of those that believed, some of them were very prominent women of the city who were Greeks, and there were also many men who believed. But then we read in verse 13, when the Jews of Thessalonica had knowledge that the word of God was preached by Paul at Berea, they came thither also and stirred up the people. Now, this really indicates a very deep animosity of the Jews against the gospel that Paul was preaching. Here they are, 60 miles away in Thessalonica. They hear that Paul is now preaching down in Berea. And so they come all of the way from Thessalonica to Berea just to stir up trouble against Paul, just to turn people away from the faith. You know, 60 miles, that isn't much. Well, have you ever walked that far? I have an uncle that used to be with us in Santa Ana, and people would say, "Well, you know, how far is it to Fullerton?" You'd say, "15 miles." He'd say, "Oh, that's not far." He said, "Have you walked it?" And if you walk it, it's quite a ways. But if you get in your car, there's not much, you know, there's not much to it getting over there. But going 60 miles walking just to harass Paul and to try to thwart his ministry there in Berea. It would be like you hearing of some teaching that was happening down in Murrieta. And there's quite a work going on down there. A lot of people are being converted, and you think, "That's terrible. I'm going to go down and stir up trouble." And you walk all the way to Murrieta just to hinder and try to hurt the work that is going on down there. That's exactly what was happening with the Jews from Thessalonica. They were so opposed to Paul and his teaching that they're going to make this journey just to hinder. And coming to Berea, they accomplished their purpose. They were able to stir up people against Paul. And so the result was that they sent Paul away to go, as it were, to the sea. Now, it was a seaport, Berea. And so they went on down as though Paul was going to get a ship and take off and go back over to Troas, maybe head home. That's what they would have liked to have seen. So they went over and they got the ship, but instead of going to Troas, they went on down to Athens. And it's about a 170-mile journey from Berea to Athens, and those of Thessalonica didn't really, I guess, want to go that far. But at any rate, it is interesting. Paul has had a pretty rough ministry in Europe. In Philippi, he was beaten and put in jail. He escaped from there to Thessalonica, but he had to leave Thessalonica under the cover of darkness. And now in Berea, they hurry him out of town, take him down, and act like they're putting him on a ship to send him home. When David Livingstone was asked where he was prepared to go, he answered, "Anywhere as long as it's forward." And that was sort of Paul's motto. I'll go anywhere as long as it's forward. Not going to go back, but anywhere as long as it's forward. Now, Timothy and Silas remained there in Berea. Evidently, to just confirm and strengthen the new believers in the faith. Paul seemed to be the chief target. He was the chief spokesman. And so he became the chief target. And he was so outspoken, so direct, that it would develop this animosity and all against him. And so the idea was, get Paul out of here. Things will cool down. We'll be able to remain and strengthen the brethren. And with Paul gone, the turmoil will be gone also. He was the chief target of the dissenters. And so they that conducted Paul brought him unto Athens. No doubt, some of the men who became believers there in Berea, recognizing that Paul's life was in jeopardy, they accompanied him more or less as bodyguards or to protect him. It is interesting how that Paul created such animosity that when he was in Damascus, first converted, there were 40 Jews who actually took a vow that they weren't going to eat until they had killed Paul. Then later on, they were attempting to kill Paul there in the temple precincts, and he was saved from the mob by a Roman guard. Then later on in Jerusalem, there were many Jews that had again vowed to kill Paul, and they were plotting. They had developed a plot to kill Paul, and the plot became known to the chief captain, and he used a Roman guard, both the infantry and the horsemen, to give Paul safe journey to Caesarea. It's an interesting thing to contrast their hatred for Paul with Paul's love for them. You know, there are some religions that engender hatred. They create great hatred. People who are followers of these religions, when you hear them talk, the venom, the hatred pours out. We've experienced personally some of that hatred that those who believe in the Islam have towards Christians. We've had them spit at us and curse us and actually declaring they wish they had a gun so they could kill us. There's a hatred there. And there was this kind of a ungodly hatred for Paul. But in contrast to their hatred for Paul, we hear Paul writing to the Romans saying, I could wish that I myself were accursed from Christ for my brothers, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. Be glad to die for them. I would be glad to be accursed from Christ if that would bring their salvation. And then again in Romans, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. I think that it is very important for us to realize that Jesus teaches us to love not those only who love us. He said, if you love those that love you, so what? Pagans do that. But you're to love those that hate you. But the danger is when someone is manifesting hatred toward me, the danger is the response of my flesh to respond in like manner. You hate me, then I'll hate you. You try to curse me, I'll curse you. That response from the flesh. And we've got to guard against that. It isn't that we are to hate those Muslims. We're not to hate them, though they do such horrible things and have such a great hatred towards the Christian and towards America. And don't think that it's just a small little minority. What the news media isn't showing you is the great rejoicing that went on throughout the Muslim world when the world towers came crumbling down. The great parties and rejoicing, not just a few, multitudes, thousands, but that shouldn't provoke from us a like response. Even as the Jews were doing their best to destroy Paul, yet his love for them was unbounded, even to the place of wishing or willing to be accursed from Christ if it would bring their salvation, for his heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel was they might be saved. Those men who accompanied Paul for his own safety to Athens, when they got there, they returned back to Berea. And Paul gave them a message to give to Silas and to Timothy to hurry down to Athens and meet him there. And so Paul is alone now in Athens. It's unfamiliar territory, and it's a city that's given over to idolatry, and Paul is now desiring for Timothy and Silas to join him as quickly as possible that they might continue on in carrying the gospel further on into Europe. And so next week, as we look at Paul in Athens, we're going to see that he just can't, you know, he's supposed to be down there for an R&R. Just sort of, you know, take it easy, Paul. Let's not stir up any more problem and all, but he just can't do it. And his heart is stirred when he sees the idolatry of this city. And he, well, it's like Jeremiah. Jeremiah was much like Paul, in that he got into real trouble for speaking the word of God. It caused him to end up in the dungeon. And as he was sinking there in that mud in the bottom of the dungeon, he said, I was determined I wasn't going to speak anymore in the name of the Lord. I mean, look what it's gotten me. Here I am, you know, giving God's word to the people, and look where I am, you know, down in this mud and sinking in this mire in the dungeon. But he said, his word was like fire in my bones, and I became weary and forbearing. I mean, it's just a fire that's burning inside, and you can't quench it. You don't want to. But you've got to speak out for Jesus Christ. And so we find Paul in Athens next week as his heart is stirred, looking at this city given over to idolatry, and the opportunity that Paul gets to, again, share the gospel there in Athens, which was, of course, the major Greek city and the center of Greek culture. And so we'll take a look at that next week. Father, how grateful we are for Paul the Apostle and his dogged determination to carry the gospel to all the world. And Lord, we thank you for the example that Paul has set for us. And even as he said, be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for a man that had such courage, such conviction, and such love. love for those who were lost, love for those that were even persecuting him, and his desire, Lord, to see them saved. Lord, give us that same kind of love and compassion for the lost, and even for those that would be persecuting us because of our stand for Jesus Christ. Lord, help us and deliver us from hatred, which is so easy when we see the horrible things that they are doing, and just looking at them with total disdain. Lord, help us to look with compassion and realize, Lord, that unless they change and accept Jesus Christ, they are destined to an eternal darkness apart from you. Give us a heart, Lord, for the lost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we stand? Sorry about being a little late tonight. I came to church, forgot it was communion, dressed in casuals. Had to go home. But we made it. The pastors are down here at the front tonight. They're here to pray for you. And again, Wednesday night, midweek, it may be that you just sort of need a little kind of a refueling tonight. Mixing in the world, it drains. It's not easy, and I understand that. Many of you are under tremendous pressure at your place of work. Some of you in school. And it is very taxing and very draining. And so the midweek becomes a very important time to gather together to just sort of get refreshed in the Lord and sort of refueled, so to speak. And so I would encourage you to spend some time in prayer before you go home. Just wait upon the Lord. Let the Spirit of God just minister to you tonight. Whatever the need might be, the Lord wants to help you and he wants to minister to you. And down here at the front, our pastors are here to minister to you and to pray for you. If you feel in need of prayer, like someone just to join with you, maybe there is a special need that you have, then just come on forward and they'll be happy to just pray for you and pray with you, that you might just experience God's touch, the refreshing of God's Spirit upon your life this evening. I will serve you because I love you. You have given life to me. I was nothing until you found me. You have given life to me. Heartaches, broken people, ruined lives are why you died on Calvary. Your touch is what I long for. You have given life to me. You have given life to me.
And now, on behalf of The Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact The Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.